All right, thanks for coming. I welcome you to yet another closeout meeting of one of the Work Package E projects, C-Share, and I had the pleasure of being the project officer. I also welcome our friends from the SGU. This is the first time we tried the video link, and I hope it doesn't break down. The presentation will be given by Max Moller, who's the project leader of the C-Share project. I suggest if we have questions, we hold our fire until the end of the presentation, so we take questions and answers at the end. All right, so okay, I'll hand it over to Max. Max, yep, all yours.
Thank you, Dirk. So I guess I have to look in that direction, Jean-Luc, to and also the audience, of course.
And there as well, to the video.
And there as well, so I have to, so my eyes will go in all directions. Okay, welcome everybody. So thank you, Dirk, for the kind introduction. As Dirk told you, I'm Max Mulder, I'm from TU Delft, and I've had the pleasure to work with Dirk on C-Share, which is one of the Work Package E projects that run in the first call. And for the past 34 months, I believe, Dirk, we were on, let's say, a journey together, also with you, to find out whether we can find, let's say, common ground in creating automation and the interface based on the same, let's say, model of the world. That's essentially what C-Share is all about. I will guide you through basically the project. I will explain what is the main philosophy and the steps that we have taken. I will explain some of the main results that we had, also experimental results that we covered. Let me first explain to you the consortium. So we were a consortium of three partners. We had the NLR from Amsterdam. We had Thales, it's a Dutch part of Thales. They are in Delft. And we from TU Delft, we were basically the consortium leader. Overall, in the past 32 months, about 16 people collaborated and contributed to the project. In particular, at TU Delft, they were the same people, apart from Geza. Geza was a student from Sweden who basically helped us in the final part of the project. And with Thales and NLR, we mainly worked with Martijn Mooi and Dennis Nieuwenhuizen. They were more kind of the constant partners there. Let's go to the next slide. So, well, this is something that I can discuss very, very briefly, I believe, because here we have all domain experts about, well, ATM and CESAR. Basically, we looked in C-Share at what we consider to be one of the core problems of CESAR, which is what will be the role of the human. On the one hand, we want to have much higher levels of automation to facilitate four-dimensional trajectory-based operations, to have much higher capacity in the airspace. Things will get more difficult also for humans to understand what's really happening because of the four-dimensionality-ness of the problem. But at the same time, CESAR says that the human will be the central part. So how do you do that with higher levels of automation and that the human is at all times the central part? We believe that when we wrote this proposal, perhaps CESAR has moved a lot ahead. It was relatively vague how those two basically conflicting, opposing views on the role of the human, higher automation and still the human will be central, how they are getting together. So we thought that in defining C-Share, that would be the problem that we would try to, not solve, but at least investigate. See if our approaches that we previously had may also work in this particular domain. So we have a pull from the demand and we have a push from technology. We can do a lot more things than previously. Can we bring those two together to create novel systems? The problem that we looked at in the end, our scope was rather large in the beginning, but we kind of limited the scope after 6 to 9 months in the project. We looked at just the basics of four-dimensional trajectory planning. This is illustrated here on this figure. This is the aircraft that we are currently observing. There may be some weather cell acting in the sector or in the airspace that we have. And at the same time, we have this requirement that the observed aircraft should be exiting the part of the sector or should be, let's say, passing this metering fix at a particular moment in time because we have a four-dimensional plan. The question then is, okay, so when we have this, what can the human or what can the automation or what can the system that we develop do in order to resolve this particular problem? We don't only have to look at ourselves, but there may also be other traffic, let's say, in the vicinity. So we have many, many constraints on basically solving this particular four-dimensional trajectory problem. Obviously, this weather cell is something that we didn't think of before. Because otherwise, the four-dimensional trajectory would not be passing it, because that's one of the key characteristics of CSIR, that if you plan lots ahead, the controller doesn't need to do a lot of tactical work anymore. So we can, automate this whole process. We have clever engineers and people who have knowledge about diverting these aircraft in the most optimal and efficient fashion. The airlines also have a larger say in solving this problem. So how do we do this in such a way that we don't miss too much revenue? But then again, when the operator, the human who would be monitoring this automatic process, would be involved and he or she would be central in this whole operation, responsible for what's happening, having to say something about this automatic solution. So then what do we do? Is this a good solution? Will this really work? Can we really be sure that the solution that the automation provides solves all possible conflicts in the best possible way? Does it also not conflict with perhaps the plans that the operator had on a strategical level? He didn't want to have a lot of traffic in this part of the airspace, for instance. He would prefer to have the traffic pass in this particular direction. So the conformness of this solution. Well, this was basically the problem that we decided to look at as a scope. It's en route traffic. It's still tactical, but I'll talk more about that at a later stage of this presentation. But that's basically the scope that we chose. Now, when you develop a system to deal with these problems, a system where automation is doing a lot of the work, because we believe that automation has lots of advances. We can do many more calculations much faster. We can take into account many, many different dimensions of solving problems. That humans cannot do that, at least not as fast as machines can do. But at the same time, that's the reason why we still have the human involved. We also would like to involve the human in a way that the human capabilities stand out, like the creative problem solving and looking through the world in the sense that things from a safety perspective are better. But when you look at the way usually the human-machine system interaction is being developed, and in particular in these technologically advanced domains as air traffic management, you often see that basically what the interface is, the automation is really mediating the way the world works to the human. So the human doesn't have a real visual relation to the things that are happening. We don't literally see the aircraft flying above us. Those aircraft and their positions and their flight paths, they're mediated through the interface. So the basic sensing and the actions that take place in this work domain, they are being done by basically the automation. They sense it, they have all the information from the communication sensors, etc. And they are also the ones that act on the world. And the way the human looks at this world is basically, well, he looks at the world through the interface. So we have usually quite visual interfaces, they are very dominant also in the air traffic domain. So the way we look at the world is, let's say, we look at the abstraction of the world, which is put into the human machine automation system. So there's not really a direct connection between what we see and what we do in the ATM world with this, let's say, high technologically advanced system as we have in the real world. So how do we build this automation in the first place? Well, we built this automation in the first place by having bright people look at the way we would like this system to be controlled. So we have typically engineers, psychologists who look at ATM domain experts. They look at the way we want to have problems solved in ATM. And for that, we need a world model. And this world model is also more like a desired world model. This is the way we want things to be controlled or organized. At the same time, when the human is working with this automation, he or she also builds a mental model of the world. And because we don't have this direct connection anymore with the real world, as we have, let's say, in many other applications, the real world is basically mediated through the automation and the human-machine system. The mental model that we develop also depends quite a bit on the model that basically is transferred through the automation. And there can in fact also be mismatches, that the human thinks that the world works in a slightly different fashion than the automation is actually, let's say, using to control the world. And the problem can be, let's say, even higher when we have multiple humans involved, which may all have their own mental model of what's happening, what is the situation and how to deal with it. So this is of course not very new, so this is a very common problem and you're all familiar with that and probably also working on that for a large part of your daily lives. And you all know that, so this can be very quickly discussed, that we have problems in having this automated approach, where we have different world models in the automation and in the humans. Well, famous example, at least in the Netherlands, is what happened in 2012. We had the Turkish airliner, which crashed right in front of the runway threshold and was flying almost completely automatically. There was a sensor going wrong, an altitude sensor. The automation made the wrong conclusion from that incoming piece of information. Well, without the pilots really being aware of it, they pulled back the complete thrust of the aircraft. Well, basically the aircraft lost most of its energy way before it was supposed to be losing its energy. Well, I believe in the air traffic domain we have also examples where humans are either distrusting or over-relying on this automation. What we want to do in C-Share is we want to make this automation. We want to design the automation in such a way that it's more transparent. That when the automation comes up with a particular solution or the operator asks the automation to come up with a particular advice, then we would like to know a little bit more about the world and the way the automation came up with this particular solution than by just showing the advice. So we want to have transparency shown. We want to basically look into why did the automation come up with this particular solution. How did we do it? And that was basically the proposal that we had. We decided to look at the possibility to find a model of the world, a functional model, that can be used both for the automation, that the automation uses this particular world model. And at the same time, we create, let's say, we use the same model for the human-machine interface. So that the automation and the human, they basically share the same model of the world. And we labeled that in, the beginning of the project to be the functional model, the functional airspace representation. More about that later. And the way we visualized then the functional airspace representation would then be the functional airspace view, the FAV. Well, the idea is that when we have the same model on which we base the automation and the human-machine interface, that these mismatches, model-to-model mismatches, would be less. And that the human would also perhaps be more inclined to use the automation because the human can better see how the automation will solve particular problems by showing really the rationale and also the constraints on which these advices are being based. The scope was quite large in the beginning, but with the help of Dirk, we made the scope much smaller. We looked at basically en route, phase of flight, so no descending and ascending aircraft. We assumed that controllers were working in an environment where basically everything is conflict-free. And that means that we have done the proper planning and the aircraft are flying their four-dimensional trajectories in the best and optimal sense. But our focus was then on if there were particular perturbations. For instance, weather or one particular aircraft could not follow its four-dimensional trajectory for some reason we don't know, but at least it's not able to comply. And also like larger perturbations, like that parts of the airspace would be unavailable for the air traffic controller. So you need to reroute many, many aircraft at the same time. So we worked on agents, the automated monitoring agents, based on basically the same model of the world. And we created an interface that basically shows how these agents work in a transparent fashion. But it also allowed the human to solve the problems manually, just without any automated help, using exactly the same constraints on which the automation is basing its resolutions. The approach that we took, it's called cognitive systems engineering, and aligned to that is ecological interface design. That's something that we have used in the past 10 years a lot in my group. Also in projects sponsored by Eurocontrol. We looked, for instance, at self-separation, so pilots who are responsible for separating their own aircraft. How can you create a system that is also showing pilots situations? So not showing solutions. So pilot, this is, we have a problem. And this is the solution that the automation shows you. No, but actually, so that can still be done. But we actually created a system there the pilot can himself or herself see what is the problem and what are the possibilities of resolving this particular problem. Yeah? And we used cognitive system engineering techniques for that. And that's also what we proposed for C-Share. If we wanted to have, and of course there are many other approaches as well, but we chose the cognitive systems engineering approach. Well, cognitive system engineering has 5 steps. I will not explain all of them. They can be found in a very nice book from Kim Vicente called Cognitive Work Analysis. At C-Share we focused on the first analysis step, which is the most important one. It's also the one that really guides the thinking about the system independently of whether it will be automated or will it be human controlled. In the work domain analysis, which took about the first half of the C-Share project, we basically thought about, so what's the purpose of the system that we're going to develop in the scope that we have chosen for this particular problem? Well, one of the ways to do that, in fact, the way to do that, according to the theory of cognitive systems engineering, is to work with abstraction hierarchies. I only show three levels. There are typically five levels of functional abstraction, and they describe the same system from five different perspectives. I will discuss the highest three levels of the abstraction hierarchy. The highest level is the functional purpose level. There we basically ask ourselves, why are we building this system? What is the purpose of this system? Remember that the system that we are now talking about is not the complete CESAR ATM air traffic management system. No, we have scoped it to en route, flights, deconflicted, but things are happening such a way that the operator or automation has to deal with perturbations. It's really a smaller scope. So as a side note, when you, for instance, in your own work, we'll try to use cognitive systems engineering techniques like the abstraction hierarchy. My main advice would be indeed to make the scope not too large, because then you will see that you get many things in your abstraction hierarchy, because usually a system has many purposes and they are all interrelated, and it will be a spaghetti mixture and you will not get any further. Let's say make the scope small enough so that you're really convinced you talk about a particular aspect of the system. Well, that's also what we did. So on the highest level, well, the highest level of having this human machine automation system is, of course, that we have safety and we have efficiency. We want to have those flights crossing the sector in a four-dimensional fashion, safely and efficiently. Then the second level, that's the most important one, it's called the abstract function level. Here we look at exactly the same system, but we don't ask ourselves, why do we actually build this system? That's the functional purpose level. Now we ask ourselves, what are the physics, the basic rules of nature, usually, which govern this system behavior? At the abstract function level, when you look at this particular problem, it is aircraft which move, they can have movement in airspace. And because we have the safety purpose, one aircraft may be an obstruction to the motion of the other aircraft in a particular way. So we have obstruction as an abstract function. Another thing that we have in order to have productivity, we need to manage perturbations. So we need something, some capability at the abstract function level that is able to manage those aircraft, to resolve conflicts and also create efficient flights. Well, then at the third level, that's the generalized function level. We again look at the system from a different perspective. Then we're going to look at, okay, so when we are building this automation or human-machine interface, or both, like in C-Share, there should be functionalities in the system that allow us to manipulate those functions at the abstract function level. So and these are not like the knobs and buttons that the controller sees. No, that's a level that's below this one. That's the physical function level, which is not discussed in this subsection hierarchy. But this is a very important level because it basically shows, okay, what kind of functionalities do we need to have in the system, either automated or through the human-machine interface, that allow the automation or human to manipulate basically the way the world works. Well, we use this philosophy to come up with a system that has the capability to do the work, to think about problems, independently of whether the human or the automation is doing it, or together, based on basically this first abstraction hierarchy. I've already explained this, so the overall system goals, the underlying laws and principles, and the realization of these abstract functions. Typically, when you use an EID view on the way many systems that we have currently in airspace are being built, and my group works a lot also on cockpits, I think when you look at the flight deck of pilots, at the interface that the pilots are using, we see that very often the highest level of the system is visible. So you can see you have part of avionics in your cockpit, and the pilots understand why it's there. Like the TCAS system, it's there, it's a last resort when the aircraft gets too close together. They also give alarms, they give signs, they give signals that something is wrong. And pilots are trained to know and understand, okay, that's TCAS, it's explaining me something about what happens in the world. What pilots also see is the physical functions. So they see, okay, then the procedure is that I turn this button, I select a particular TCAS climb or descent rate, they instruct their autopilots, and that's it for them. But why they're doing it, what's the rationale behind it, and that, which is basically using your autopilot, with using these functions here, you are in fact working on the third level of the abstraction hierarchy, and that works on the second level of the abstraction hierarchy. Here we are changing the behavior of this system. And in most cockpit systems that we have currently, we see that that's hidden. That's part put into the automation. And pilots have difficulty to understand why is the automation doing this. So we didn't want to do that with C-Share. We think that when you create more automation in ATM, you need to create automation that shows all levels of the abstraction hierarchy to the human operator. So that the auto operator, him or herself, can look and can also better understand the way the world works. Creates a much better mental model about what's really happening out there, not something that's mediated completely through the automation, which may be, let's say, hiding things for the operator, perhaps unintentionally, we don't know. We believe that when you have this transparency in automation, that also the acceptance of the operator to work with this automation may actually benefit from that, because the operator can really see the way it works and evaluate in much more team working style how the automation comes up with a particular resolution. What did we do? So we think it's important when you think about this representation of the airspace to both create the automation as well as the human machine interface from the same perspective. In order to do that, we also look, apart from the functional abstraction that we have just discussed, we also look at the basic constraints that both the operator as well as the automation has, because that's the way the world works. Aircrafts cannot fly at infinite speeds. They cannot fly with zero speeds from the ground. Typical constraints from the own aircraft perspective, from the whole air traffic perspective, from the fact that we have many other aircraft flying around there, the constraints that weather cells may impose on the motion, the locomotion of this particular aircraft. So we first looked at the internal constraints. Suppose you would be an air traffic controller working on this particular aircraft, because of this weather cell, we need to divert. We have to change the four-dimensional trajectory. We still have the time constraint, so we still want it to be at the metering fix at this particular time. But we don't want to fly through the weather cell, and we also don't want to harm this other aircraft's trajectory. Well, first, when you look at your own aircraft, then typically aircraft, they cannot, turn extremely fast. So there's like a reasonable turn rate that you can require an aircraft to turn. So this would be like the most extreme turn towards the left of this particular aircraft, and just the most extreme turn towards the right. Well, we also have that here. So suppose the aircraft would be flying like here, then it can still make the metering fix by, taking this trajectory and then having this extreme turn towards the left. And, those extremities, they are, of course, a function of many things. Comfort of passengers, for instance. You don't want to fly at incredible G levels. So these are very, very smooth trajectories that we used in C-Share. Well, the second constraint that you then have, this is like an internal constraint, internal to the aircraft itself. But there are also other constraints. So when you look at the constraints imposed on the aircraft because of the time, you can imagine that when you would change the trajectory, you would create an intermediate waypoint at the position where now the mouse pointer is located, then the distance that the aircraft has to travel is longer. Well, when you fly at constant speed with a longer distance, then your time constraint will not be met. And when you put an intermediate waypoint here, for this particular observed aircraft to circumvent the weather cell, so you put it here, then the aircraft has to fly 10 knots faster in order to still meet the time constraint. And of course, when you put the waypoint further down, the distance to be flown increases, and therefore also the speed that you need to choose for this particular aircraft also increases, up until the aircraft simply cannot fly any faster. But that's another internal constraint of the aircraft. So then you create a kind of a travel space. So these are all the possible, points where I can put, for instance, intermediate waypoints for this particular aircraft in such a way that we circumvent this particular weather cell. These constraints also show me that I also want to have the aircraft arrive there on time. So I can see something about, what will be the consequences in terms of changing speed for that particular aircraft. Now, this is of course purely looking at the fact that we have this aircraft which needs to divert because of this weather cell and still needs to be on time at the metering fix. It's kind of a small problem. But the problem becomes, of course, a lot more complicated when we have other aircraft flying around. This aircraft, which is flying there, it's rather close, and you look at its headings. They're approaching each other. This aircraft will also pose particular constraints to the motions that this observed aircraft can take in the future. When you do that, and that's something that we do both analytically, now we can create analytically what we call restricted fields of travel. It doesn't mean that the aircraft cannot fly in the red zone. What it means is that when I create an intermediate waypoint for this particular aircraft to divert this particular weather cell, because of this other aircraft, I cannot put the waypoint into the restricted field of travel. So that's essentially what it shows, what it can show to the operator. But that's exactly the same constraint for the automation. The automation also cannot put any waypoint in here, because then this aircraft will indeed divert and will, not cross the weather cell, but it will get too close to the other aircraft, because this restricted field of travel is because of this other aircraft. And you can imagine that when we have many more aircraft flying around, then the restricted field of travel will be, just the summation of the consequences of all these other aircraft on the possibilities of resolving the problem for this observed aircraft. And so we have safe field of travel now, so I can put waypoints in here and here. And then indeed, then I will resolve the problem in terms of the weather cell. And also, I will not, hurt or harm, the trajectory of this particular aircraft. So can you really put a waypoint there? Yes, you can put a waypoint there, because at the moment where this aircraft is there, then this aircraft will be flying over there. So it's a four-dimensional problem. So we have these analytical calculations of restricted field of travel. That's something we developed also in C# for this particular problem. Now you see that when you map all these constraints of the world of this four-dimensional trajectory problem, we get a visualization of constraints. It shows to the operator, these are things that you cannot do in the world, and these are things that may solve your problem. It doesn't say anything about, put your waypoint here or there. It just shows you, essentially, don't put it here. Again, I would like to emphasize that exactly the same constraints they hold for the automation, obviously, because this is a property of the world. It's the way the world works. It's at the abstract function level where we have these constraints. Okay, so I have a little movie. In fact, I have two movies. This is the interface that we made and evaluated in C#. We took a part of the airspace. It's the lower part of the FABEC zone across Belgium. We used in our evaluations traffic samples that we got from Eurocontrol. It's not something that we figured out ourselves. And we looked at still a rather conservative approach. So we had sectors defined. In the sector we have aircraft flying with four-dimensional trajectories. Those aircraft, they enter the sector at particular points and they leave the sector at particular points. And all those points, they have times allocated to them. We don't look at altitude. We only look at the two dimensions of this particular en route flight. What you see here, for instance, so before the movie starts, because the movie is perhaps a little fast, is that we have two aircraft in this sector, and apparently we have a problem. This aircraft and this aircraft will get too close to each other in terms of distance. We will have a loss of separation and nothing happens. Then we're going to work on this particular aircraft. So the air traffic controller has selected this aircraft. Then two things pop up. So we see the point where this aircraft is supposed to be leaving the sector and with what particular time. And also the safe and restricted fields of travel pop up. So that means that in order to resolve this particular conflict, I can create a waypoint in one of the green areas. And those ellipses, the ellipse shapes, they also show the consequences in terms of the speed increase needed for this aircraft in order to still make the time at the final waypoint. Okay, so I will start the movie. Okay, so I'll explain from here how the movie what it works. So we see the same sector. The automation has found out, typically as what is also happening now, that two aircraft, they will have a particular conflict. All the other aircraft were deconflicted, so for some particular reason we have a conflict here, so the operator needs to resolve it. then basically what happens is that the operator can look at all the other aircraft and their travel spaces. And in this case, it can see that indeed we have a red zone, which is over here, so that those two aircraft will have a problem. So I will go back to this part. Yeah. So here we see the travel space, the restricted and the safe field travel for this particular aircraft, which has to leave the sector over here. And it has a problem with that aircraft. And now the air traffic controller is manually resolving this conflict. That's something that our system allows the operator to do. Later on, I will show you how this goes automatically. You will see that it will be exactly the same. So we have exactly the same interface for the full automation as well as the full manual control. What the operator will do is that, and that's what he does now. So he clicks into the safe field travel. Then a new waypoint is being created. It means that the aircraft has to fly a little faster in this direction, has to fly a little faster in that direction. That's something that we could see in the safe field travel. You immediately see also the safe fields of travel from flying from this waypoint, from the current position to there, and from this waypoint to there. So we can see that it's completely conflict-free. That's something that we could already see in the previous, shot. And the controller simply tells the pilot to go in this particular direction. So it's a little simplified, perhaps a lot simplified. What I've shown you is the situation where the air traffic controller decides him or herself to resolve this particular conflict. But we created, together with our partners also, the automation using exactly the same constraints. It used the same rules, so where can we put waypoints in this particular problem? The advantage of using the automation then comes in, and that's something that you can also explain to air traffic controllers, which is what we did later on, is that when the automation comes in, then we can do many more calculations. We can do real mathematical, optimization for this particular problem. Yeah? But even when we're optimizing, mathematically for resolving this particular conflict, those basic constraints are exactly the same. And visualizing them onto the interface, even when the automation does the work, still means that the operator can see, okay, so this is really the situation. And the automation is advising me to take this particular resolution. And I can check myself that indeed the automation is giving me an answer that or a solution that will work. That will work, and I can also see perhaps the rationale behind it. The advantage, of course, relative to the manual resolution, is that when you do it automatically, you can do many more optimization techniques. So the minimization of path lengths to facilitate airlines in a better way, etc. So this is now what the automation will tell the air traffic controllers. So we have this conflict. The controller can ask automation, what do you advise? The automation comes up with this particular waypoint. The air traffic controller can see, that makes sense because it's in the safe field travel. Apparently, the automation wants it to fly to the northern part of the sector, which is something that perhaps at a higher level would be better for this particular situation. So we can really see through what is proposed. So I have the next one. So that's basically the transparency that we are creating. The next movie will be very similar to what I have. So here we have again the sector. We have again that the operator can still look at all these aircraft and look at their travel spaces to see, do we have many conflicts? Will we have situations perhaps in the future where aircraft will be flying very close together, so we have a high density there. But here the controller, so he's still looking at all the aircraft, he's asking automation, this is what he has done now, for a particular resolution. And in C#, so you can imagine that in many situations there will be many more possible solutions for this particular. This is a simple conflict, but when you have more multiple aircraft, there will be also many more solutions possible. So in C# we chose that the automation will always give three possible solutions to the operator. That's also something I believe that you can see here. So those are the three, and the operator can switch between them. And it chooses one particular solution. And that's essentially the way it works with the full automation. Oh, you have a question, sorry, yeah.
How many conflicts that we said can be solved?
Okay.
If there is going that is processed.
In the automation?
Yeah, because here we have three aircraft.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the automation is based on the rapid random trees algorithm from NLR. They had already this algorithm, and we used it essentially in C-Share. I don't know the literature extremely well, but I think they can up to 7 or 8 aircraft at the same time, or even higher.
7 or 8 aircraft in conflict, not
exactly. Involved in exactly the same conflict. In our scenarios, we never had more than 3. Aircraft involved. This interface, which complies with the definition that we have in the literature for joint cognitive systems. So what is a joint cognitive system? That's a system which can provide cognition. So can do work, can solve particular problems that we didn't think of when fully programming the rules in a particular system. So we need cognition. In a joint cognitive system, it's typically a human and automaton working together. In C-Share, I think we have created one of the first truly joint cognitive systems for ATM, for the four-dimensional trajectory management. Because the human is involved together with the automation in monitoring this particular part of the en route traffic. When something happens, the automation can resolve the conflict and the operator can say, yes, indeed, I like this conflict resolution, do it. Management by consent. But at the same time, the human can also do the conflict resolution by him or herself. So we have both partners. The human automation system can do the work. They can do it together. When things get very busy, the operator can choose to put more work to the automation. So you resolve this conflict. Ah, I like your resolution. And when situations are differently, the operator can choose to resolve the conflicts by him or herself. We did some evaluations with this system throughout the project. In fact, we did 2 real experiments in the end, the human in the loop studies number 2. Well, this figure nicely illustrates that we didn't go from a first design to the final experiment. That, I think that's also typical for the cognitive systems engineering approach, is that you need iterations. The model of the world, the abstraction, the hierarchy, the representation that you take may not be complete. So what we did is that in our design cycle, we had our first functional airspace representation. We put that on paper, so we didn't program anything. We put them on sheets and we presented them to experts. We had 7 domain experts from ATM, air traffic controllers, people who worked for ATM for many years. And we discussed with them the basic concept of this is the scope that we have, this is what we would like to develop. Based on that evaluation, which was just a paper evaluation, we created the first version of the joint cognitive system, something that was truly interactive. Controllers could actually work with our system. We had a visualization, we have the automation in place. And we did a first human in the loop experiment actually here at Bretigny. We had the pleasure to work with 3 very experienced air traffic controllers who also knew what was coming with César. And from that we had also quite some very good insights into some of the functional aspects of the interface, the direct manipulation type of things that we created. We got some really good feedback on that. And based on that iteration, we came up with the final version, which is the current version of the joint cognitive system. And that version has been evaluated in 2 larger scale experiments. Finally, so I will discuss that later on, we had a workshop with also experts explaining what we did, what was our approach to get their feedback, etc. So we had actually a quite nice evaluation of everything that we did. This slide shows you a little bit of the things that we developed throughout the project. So we ended with this one, the final joint cognitive system that we experimentally validated. But we started from here. This was where TU Delft has worked on for many years. Just the separation assurance. This is an ecological interface for air traffic controllers or pilots, showing what the relative motion of these 2 elements in airspace actually means. This is our first version of the 4-dimensional traffic trajectory problem. Then we came with this one, which we evaluated with the Eurocontrol domain experts and air traffic controllers, who advised a lot about the functionality in terms of putting these waypoints and what kind of rubrics do you need in there. And this is the final version that we evaluated. Okay, so I'll get through this because this is what I explained. This is what we showed in the Bretigny. We took our system and had a few days here with air traffic controllers. So I'll go through the main evaluation that we had. Actually, we did 2 experiments in the end. We thought that one big experiment would become too large. We would have too many experimental variables. It would be very difficult to get any statistical significance. So we basically did 2 experiments, which were very much the same. So the independent variables were the same. So we had structured and unstructured traffic. Structured means that the traffic in the sector follows particular kind of deterministic, easily predictable paths. And the unstructured part is kind of the opposite of that. And we had three scales of perturbation. Small perturbation, so that means that the air controller was confronted with situation in the sector where just a few aircraft needed to be rerouted. And the large perturbation meant that about 11 to 13 aircraft needed a new route. Well, this was basically factorial design, so we had six experimental variables. Okay, the experiments that we did, so we did one experiment where it was fully manual, and so just to evaluate the human machine system itself, that the air controller did all the work. And in the second experiment, we had the automation also in place. So there, the air controller could work together with the automation to resolve these particular conflicts. So we created different scenarios because we were quite lucky to have 12 subjects which were also available for the second experiment. So apart from two subjects, but well, at least 10 were doing the same experiment. So we looked at safety and performance, the workload of the controllers, the acceptance of the controllers, and also we looked at did the controllers actually use the advisories that were given. Okay, so this is something that I explained. So we had two experiments, 12 participants. For the sake of perhaps your interest, did any conflicts happen in this system? Yes, it did. It occurred twice. We had almost 2,200 controlled flights in total with 12 subjects in two experiments with six independent variables. Only in two situations we had a loss of separation where aircraft came too close to each other. We also have had two situations where aircraft entered a part of the airspace which was restricted. So in the large perturbation case, we had that suddenly a part of the airspace, which was completely working according to plan with the 4D trajectories, was not available anymore for some reason. And then the aircraft needed to get different routes. Okay, so when you look at the workload for the two experiments, so this is experiment one, this is experiment two, this is a small, the medium, and the large perturbation. And this was the structured traffic, and this was the unstructured traffic. Well, but you can see, obviously, when the perturbation gets larger, the operator has more work, so the workload gets higher. We also found that well, when you had the manual control, that there wasn't a lot of difference between the unstructured and structured patterns. We did find that with the surprisingly with the experiment number two, where we had the automated agents in place, we actually, which was kind of contradictory to our expectation, the workload ratings of controllers was lower in the unstructured patterns relative to the structured patterns. Of course, this may be an artifact, because when you have unstructured patterns, then it could be that the difficulty of the task is in fact lower, because perhaps there is a more of a dispersion of the aircraft across the sector. This is also an interesting one when you look at the acceptance rating. So I should say that we had three groups of participants. So we had students who all know ATM very well. They are doing their graduation projects also in ATM studies. We had domain experts, and those were people who had an academic background, also working in ATM, and they did an extensive training at NLR. NLR provides training for air traffic control, about a week, so they know about air traffic control, at least in the Netherlands. And we had four air traffic controllers. They were all area controllers from the Netherlands. Now, when you look at the two experiments, the cars, the acceptance ratings, you see that the students accepted the automation, or the interface in this case, quite well, the automation as well. When you see the domain experts, they were already less positive, although the acceptance rate was still quite high. Or even higher, I should say, in the case when there was automated agents available. When you look at the controllers, there was typically one controller who didn't accept anything that we did, which is, well, perhaps typical. Hey, I see many smiling faces here. It's typical. You cannot blame them because people have their own idea about how the air traffic control is being done, which is, of course, biased by the way we do it now. Whereas with systems like these, we look 10, 15, perhaps 20 years into the future. So it's hard to imagine what the world looks like at that moment. Do we accept, actually, the interface taken? But then we were kind of still very happy with the high ratings that we got for at least the manual part. Controllers were less positive about having the automated agents having a role, even when the role of the automated agents was voluntary. So they could still, in this experiment, do all the work by themselves. So we didn't instruct them to use the... The CARS rating. It's a NASA rating. It's a controller acceptance rating scale. It's like...
Cooper Harper for controllers.
Yeah. Yeah. So 10 is high acceptance. So... really well done, and one is, no, I don't accept this system at all.
You said it was one controller, but it looks like there's about far left with about 7.
Yes, but after every run, the aircraft, controllers could give their cars rating. Yeah, so we have, indeed, we had only one controller giving all these bad ratings. But so we have many more ratings than we had, just subjects. Yeah, I should have explained that, sorry. But this is also an interesting one. It shows for experiment number 2, where we had these automated agents in place. For the students, the domain experts, and the additive controllers, the number of resolutions advisories that they asked for, which is basically adding those two together. So the additive controllers, they asked for 33 advisories in the second experiment, and the students asked for many, many more. Then the pluses indicate, did they actually accept the advice? And the minus, did they actually turn down the advice? What you see is that controllers don't ask for a lot of automated help. Students, they like it the most. The domain experts, they're kind of in the middle. Generally, the students and domain experts are also more inclined to follow the advice of the automation. But the additive controllers, they weren't. They were more like 50-50. And that's also what is shown over here. We did a very nice workshop, I believe, in the end. It was in September. It was at the Thales grounds in Delft, where we had people from ATM communities, pilots. We had John Fleck from Wright State University, a famous professor who was also in Delft in that week. We showed them the interface. First we explained, of course, the philosophy of C#. Then the experts, they worked with the interfaces. And then we had a SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. In an interactive session where we asked people to state possible threats, for instance, and we listed them all, and then we asked all of the members of the workshop to rate whether you agreed with that particular statement given by other members. So I put the most important ones down here. So these are strengths and weaknesses. I'm not sure if you're familiar with SWOT, but strengths and weaknesses, they are about the system itself. It has strong points and it has weaknesses. The opportunities and threats are more like, how will this thing be evaluated in the outside world? What are the opportunities and also what are the threats that you see? So they were scored like this. You could give 5 points, 3 points, or 1 point. Here in this case, 7 people gave 5 points, 4 people gave 3 points, and 3 people gave 1 point. So a total of 50. That's essentially the points that this one gets. When you look at the workshop results, people very much liked the direct manipulation capabilities. That's also something that we deliberately put in. We want people to have direct interaction with the interface that really allows them to work on the world as represented by the human-machine system. Surprisingly, they found it easily to understand. This was one of our concerns, but the domain experts, at least, they very much liked it. They liked the transparency, that it was easy to interpret. And one of the main opportunities that they saw, we were very happy to get such a positive comments, was that they said, well, when you are going towards high levels of automation, like in César, you have an acceptance issue. The approach that we took with C#, joint work, creating automation that is transparent and that can allow operators to be involved in their task, will be much more acceptable. So you can get to a higher level of automation, then also the people will still like their job and still appreciate it. The threats that we had was, of course, that first of all, something that we have investigated also in another project, Mufasa. It's about conformance. So you get free advices, but those free advices may not be what you actually want. But then the nice thing, of course, of C# would be to say, well, I don't like the automated advice. I take my, I do it manually. I resolve it in the way that I want the situation to be done. Because I have perhaps another reason to move the traffic more toward the lower side of the sector for this moment in time. The controllers, they have strategies themselves. Another thing that people didn't like, so there was a weakness. They didn't like that we only look at conflicts. A lot of the comments that we got was also like, okay, but how do I know whether this is optimal, or whether this is the best solution? That's something that we can investigate to put transparent layers of information telling operators something about optimality. Another thing that the experts didn't like, and that's also said something that the additive controllers didn't like in the experiment, was that they still had to work a lot on individual aircraft. They would like to have more tool that allows them to work on groups of aircraft or streams of aircraft. So the basic outcomes were that, well, we did design a first working joint human automation prototype, a joint cognitive system. We believe that the approach really helps to coordinate human-machine and automation coordination, which will be more acceptable to get the acceptance from the people that need to work with it. One of the quotes that I liked from one of the people from the workshop was that, well, did you do this in 2 years? You need another 2 years or 4 years to extend it, to make it more visible also to the community, so that the approach taken led to this particular interface for this particular scope. But it's the approach that we envisage that may be also usable in many other domains. So we had many papers, but many will still follow Dirk, I promise, because we're still working on it. So this is the thing that we would like to be working on, also based on comments that we got from the ad hoc controllers in our experiments and the domain experts, which was that, well, when you have situations like these or any other situation, that our current interface still requires the operator to basically work on all these individual aircraft, whereas he or she could already think about the fact that, well, I would like to have these aircraft move in that direction and this group of aircraft to move in that direction. I think the next step of C-Share could be that we go from basically the component level, looking at aircraft as being little components that need to be controlled. We start to look at streams and see if we can create an interface for four-dimensional air trajectory-based operations, where operators are really, perhaps the fringe, they can select particular groups of aircraft and they can say, well, this stream, I would like to move it up, or this stream, I would like to move it down. And what are the constraints in doing that? Whereas all these aircraft then still need to be on time, let's say, at particular points in the sector or at the sector boundaries. So more like a flow-based management. Okay, so having said that, I apologize for taking the full 75 minutes, which I never experienced. I hope you enjoyed my story, and I'm open for questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Shall we give the floor to the SGU first if you have questions?
What was the rationale for not including the vertical dimension? I mean, you deliberately excluded it, and it's written that way, and the controllers have identified it too in your SWOT analysis, but there must be some rationale for doing that.
Yeah, so the rationale was actually pretty simple, was to limit the work that we had. It was a huge problem in the beginning, and so when you look at the C-Share proposal, we were proposing actually a lot more than just also including the vertical traffic. And so it was really, let's say, bluntly stated, it was to limit our work. So there was not really like a rationale other than that. Yeah.
We're just sort of challenging ourselves as well about, is that a limitation that's sufficiently large where it affects the results, as in by removing that dimension, do you affect the outcome of the whole thing, because you're just constraining yourself to the lateral problem?
Yeah. So I don't think that the approach itself will be wrong, will prove to be wrong when we have also the vertical dimension increased. But obviously it does make the problem a whole lot more difficult. Not only in terms of coming up with resolutions and thinking about how to do it optimally, but also to present it to the operator, because we still have just a limited piece of glass in between the operator and the automation. So including the third dimension will indeed be a challenge. I must say, however, that for self-separation in the cockpit, so for pilots, we have a three-dimensional self-separation displays. But that's an egocentric perspective, because then the pilot is responsible for just one aircraft. And one of the challenges that we see also in air traffic control is that controllers need an exocentric perspective, because they need to deal with all the aircraft almost simultaneously.
I'd like to come to your help, Max, because I feel partly guilty for that. When we kicked off this project, the scope initially, as it always is, was very, very wide. We thought, well, we can play around with everything and probably not get anywhere, not produce anything useful. Or we can try to narrow down the scope to one specific application that we are more confident can be solved. And that's actually what we did. This is also the reason why we focused on en route traffic only. It's also the reason why, for example, we excluded speed control. Speed control, I think, is a task that could benefit a lot from this approach, converting a mental task into a perception task. I think speed control would be extremely an interesting field of application. But we decided to narrow the focus very, 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 very narrowly in order to get to something more to get a higher probability of actually delivering something.
Yeah, I mean, speed control is interesting because there's a real preference at the moment for the aircraft to fly slower, and your scenarios were all speed-up scenarios. So they really are driving us to want to slow down to resolve issues rather than speed up, and that's because of the fuel situation.
Actually, if I may jump in here at that point, it would be interesting to see how we could, given the preference for speed control that you mentioned, Peter, it would be worth thinking a little bit about how such a joint cognitive system could be used in order to support the task of speed control for an air traffic controller.
Yep, definitely. And we built again for the cockpit case, for the pilot case, we have those designs already available. I think it would be a relatively small amount of work to basically create an interface that also includes those speed opportunities. Yeah, dynamically.
Just one of the things I've kind of missed throughout this, and I know we're talking a little bit about the problem that you're solving at this stage, but if I just take this back, you presented a lot of the theory of automation interface to the human, the relationship, the understanding, perceptions, all this sort of thing. And then we jump to the, and here's the problem we're going to solve. I don't see as clearly the link that says this is the best answer to the theory of ensuring that the automation and the human are kept in alignment, they're kept in synchronization. You know, the objective was, as you described it, was to ensure that you had the right fit between the automation level and the human, and the perceptions were the same. And I see a solution, and videos of a solution, the theory presented, but I didn't see the connection.
Yeah, I agree. The best way to look at that would be to create two competing teams. One team that would use this approach to design a system based on these requirements, and to have another team to use another approach. It could be a more traditional approach, trying to solve for the same requirements, and then have those teams challenge each other. So I think what you miss, and which is indeed true, is that we don't have a baseline display. We don't have when we would not follow this approach, we would come up with this particular human-machine automation combination, and now we have made something new, and it is so much better. Indeed, there is no proof that the new, let's say, philosophy has led to a better design, because we don't have the baseline yet. Does that answer your question?
It goes part of the way, and it opens up a discussion around the question that Taylan raised earlier, which is if Taylan was operating today's system and he would rubber band and extend the route to avoid metrology, like met conditions, he could do that today, and that's in a way the baseline that's in his head. And you presented something which is an alternative, and that's why I was going down this path. Well, how do we know whether we've got something better, or whether we've just solved the same problem with a different representation but no real advantage?
Yeah.
And then we've got the controller view, but the controllers weren't necessarily today's controllers that are working with that baseline system. That's kind of where I'm coming from. How do we resolve that?
Yep.
The question, Taylor, was answering.
Good question.
I think the ambition of Sisha was not to develop a system that could be used straight away. I think it was to explore the suitability of a specific concept, and the beauty I see in it is that the interface allows for varying levels of automation without changing the interface. So actually you can play around with levels of automation without changing the interface.
Exactly.
Yeah, so that comes back to my question, which is, it feels as if we're overplaying this is the answer, and underplaying this is the research about how to understand the relationship between the automation and the human, and how to improve it, and therefore design better systems. And that's a bit I was kind of missing.
I've no other answers to that.
We have some more questions. I have a question. You, maybe I'm wrong, but I haven't seen that. You have never defined the time horizon of this tool. Is it a tactical tool? Is it a planner tool? What is the time horizon? Is it the tool for the executive controller or the planner controller?
Good question. Is that already clear? How that will be done in the future? So we know how it's done now in current airspace. We have the executive, we have planners. But is that already something that we see in the future as well? Because we're talking about a future system now. So it's completely 4D trajectory based. And perhaps we will not have those to distinguish those two functions anymore.
But in your experiment, yeah. Will they... operating tactically?
They were operating mostly tactically, yes, indeed.
What would you change in the future? What is the ground of that? I mean, you didn't explain it for
long. So we took the perspective that César will be implemented and all aircraft will fly contracts, fully four-dimensional trajectories. That's our starting point. So we didn't look at how to get there. No, we take it from there. So we say, okay, we have an airspace where now everything is based on position and time and contracts. And for that system, which is completely deconflicted, which is optimally planned, we look at how to support the human when we have to monitor a system like that when perturbations occur. That's the starting point that we had. Does that answer your question?
Well, I mean, on board the aircraft, there would be similar things as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Actually, yeah. Algorithms to avoid those conflicts. I mean, on board the aircraft, in the future, you will have the same kind of possibility for the pilot.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Obstacles, whether, but that was not studied here, was it?
No. No, we assume that those aircrafts in our airspace, in the future airspace, they're all equipped with very accurate four-dimensional trajectory-based flight management systems. And you saw, for instance, that when the aircraft, when the controller was doing a reroute, he defined new waypoints. Yeah. He's not telling the operator or the pilot to go to the left with this particular speed. No, he says, this will be your trajectory. This will be your new trajectory. So the controller is, in fact, on the ground manipulating the trajectories of aircraft, which will be changed also in their systems. This is how far the concept will go. You know, and that's, I've already seen it with, so I've done other projects as well with four-dimensional trajectory management. But it will take the system in a completely different realm than the current system. It will really change dramatically. So it's not a great, so it's a really a paradigm difference. Sorry?
Do you think the aircraft will be initiating the, in this case, weather avoidance, or is it controller initiated?
In C-Share it was controller initiated. Because it was still managed airspace. The controller is responsible for the separation. But I can imagine that when you have unmanaged airspace, and still somebody from the ground perhaps looking at the way it's being done, then that will be the pilot doing the self-separation, defining new waypoints. Yeah, and that those waypoints then will then also be visible on the interface of the controller who will be monitoring that. But it's about exchanging contracts.
Even before self-separation, that would occur because you've already got on the aircraft the ability to detect, they then analyze the meteorology conditions ahead of the aircraft on its predicted route. And it's already, as you explained, on a contract with the ground.
Yep.
And it's also able to renegotiate that contract. And I would expect the aircraft will, having seen that weather, they will determine whether they're going to do an avoidance, and they prefer an avoidance. They initiate a renegotiation based on the preferred avoidance route, including waypoints, which is as you described, that would come down to the controller. The controller needs to look at the overall flow repercussions, which is where then your tool could be supporting.
Indeed.
And then the agreement to that would go back to the aircraft for information.
Definitely.
That's why I was asking, because I think that it's going to come from the aircraft.
Can I take questions from Brittany?
Yeah, I have some observations. I mean, there's kind of an interesting irony of automation design here, because you've taken the right process. You've had controls at the beginning to help you design it, then controls at the end to help you test it. But those controls at the end didn't like what the original controls obviously can see, and so I'm just wondering what we do with that, because where do we go from there?
Yeah, it's a good question. So personally, I think that we created novel interfaces for the past 5 to 6 years, also in other domains. So we also looked at arrivals management, for instance, at Schiphol. The thing is that when you move to a system where things will be in 4D, there will be a four-dimensional trajectory contracts, it will be a big difference. It will really be a big difference, because it allows us, both people in the air and as well as people on the ground, to do different strategies. And we can create completely different visualizations as well. One of the things, for instance, Barry, that you can do with 4D trajectory management, which is different from today, is that you can look into the future much more accurately. So that means that we can develop interfaces that allow, for instance, controllers to see how the traffic will emerge in the next 4 to 5 minutes, because everybody's flying the four-dimensional trajectory. One of the things that we developed for Schiphol, for the arrival management there, was that in a four-dimensional trajectory environment is that you have the possibility as a controller to, for instance, do all kinds of what-if scenarios virtually with the interface supported by the automation. For instance, like that would be like a KLM flight with somebody important on board who needs to be, let's say, at the threshold earlier than expected. So how do you deal with that? So now then you can create, let's say, with four-dimensional trajectory management, much better interfaces to show that, okay, then this preferred passenger needs to arrive there at that moment. This is the route that needs to be taken by that particular aircraft, preferred route from KLM, because they want this passenger to be on board. And at the same time, we can look at the consequences for the others. So then this aircraft has to merge before the others. And we can look into the future, you know, and that's one of the nice aspects of 4D trajectory management. And that allows us also as human machine system designers to create quite new interfaces. But to answer your question, Barry, because I'm not answering your question, I'm sorry. When we go to that new system, so I see very little awareness of the consequences for the additive controllers in terms of it will change. It will dramatically change when we move to there. And their work will change. And so for controllers, it's very hard to envision that. In particular, because you have been working with these tools for so many years. Things haven't changed a lot for so many years. And people are skeptical, of course, also. You have skepticism, you have biases. But the essence of what I'm trying to say, Barry, is that indeed it's hard to imagine, I think, for controllers what's going to happen.
I think it was hinted at by Peter Russell's. Yep. Peter.
Yep.
What to me is missing, so I know King Vicente's methods. I've always found them nice, but very hard to actually apply. You need something that's going to be like a cognitive requirements analysis, which is really going to, not just the controllers thinking, well, how could we do it, but really extracting from it, how should they do it, how do they actually think about it, how do they do it.
Yep.
And that to me is missing a little bit. I also think, as was said in Brussels, we have a lot of really good tactical tools right now.
Yeah, yeah, I agree.
Which do this part.
Yeah.
But the flow management is actually what you hinted at in the last slide is the really interesting bit.
Yeah, I agree.
That's where I think you could go with this.
Barry, could I still try to answer your question? Because I had something.
I answered my own question.
Yeah, yeah. No, but I have another answer. Imagine asking a pilot in the early 1970s whether he or she would like to work with the flight management systems that we have today. Majority will say, I don't like it.
Yeah.
Majority of the people who are working with them now, they say it's the best thing that ever happened on this flight deck. It's really...
They didn't use this process. I think we're...
No, but I can imagine that when they... So when the oil crisis kicked in and the avionics manufacturers had to build the flight management system to keep the airlines, let's say, afloat, that they also did usability tests. Many with pilots, and I'm quite sure because my, let's say, I have a colleague who's much older than I was, and he was a professional pilot. So he worked throughout that era of the flight management system approaching. And he said to me that indeed in the old days they were incredibly biased against these new procedures. This computer cannot fly better than I do. You know, it's very much to the stick and rudder. But now, when they look back, they say, no, it's the best thing that ever happened. So that may also be true for the F controllers.
More questions?
You mentioned there were two losses of separation.
Yeah.
Was that involving the advisories, students, controllers?
So we had two losses of separations. One of them was with students. And one was with the domain experts. It didn't happen with the controllers. No.
I'm really sorry.
Yeah.
If I may, I have a question for you, Max.
Yeah.
That is a bit more philosophical, perhaps, there's an assumption in our community that if you make an interface richer, it provides more information and situation awareness is improving, and then task performance is improving and workload is reducing. But there's not a whole lot of evidence for that relationship, and there are actually even some hints that the opposite may be true in some cases, including the Mufasa project that you worked on. Would you give us a feeling for what might be true and what not?
No, not really. What may be true? Eh? So the thing is that, and that's also what you see in those ecological interfaces. They will become as complex as the work being done eventually, because they have to capture all the constraints that are out there. And the things that that we see then is that indeed that things get more complicated. The display gets more complicated. So it may also be that we run out of dimensions for the display. Because there are so many more dimensions that comes to solving particular problem than the things that we just have been developing. I think in the end, what is important is that when you want to have the operators really involved and having them really understand what's going on, they need very good mental models. And those mental models need to be stimulated at very high levels of granularity. So they need to understand many situations and have experience with dealing with that. And I think that when you want to support people in doing that, you can either train them, train them and have the granularity there, or you, create an interface where basically granularity is also there, but then the interface will be complex. So indeed, there could be like a middle way somewhere where complexity of the situation will be mapped onto the interface in a less complex way, in such a way that at least the operator will still cope with the level of complexity that he has to deal with at that particular moment.
There's a penalty for displaying too
much. Yeah, I think, yes, in that respect, I do agree.
More questions?
In your documents, you imply that your project is 4D compliant. So what is your exact understanding of four-dimensional trajectory? So when I look at the document, the system only provides solutions in two-dimensional.
I think we used a very common sense approach to the definition of 4D trajectories. So as you could have seen, our simulations are also pretty simple. So we could sustain that common sense definition. It means that those particles, those elements in the airspace, they are at a particular position at a particular time. We define times at entering the sector, crossing the sector, the new waypoints that the operators put into the airspace to resolve particular problems.
And I have one remark about that also. Adding waypoints to the trajectory is not a new thing. In the current environment, you can add as more as you want, to the trajectory. The only deficiency is you can't uplink to this information to the aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
But in the trajectory, you can add waypoints as a air traffic controller.
I know that pilots can do that, but air traffic controllers can do that too?
Some centers,
Okay.
Maastricht, for example.
Okay.
But that's not really the new thing of C-Share to be able to add waypoints. The new thing is the visualization of the constraints that you put away by
the server. I have the impression that it's something like explained as a new functionality. It's not a new functionality for me, because it's already new. As I thought, the only deficiency is the deficiency of uplinking the information to the aircraft.
Can you get the downlink?
Also, it's not present right now, but it's in the scope of sensor. I just wanted you to clarify the four dimensions. It just in the document you see everywhere the four dimensions.
The contribution of C-Share is it's an evaluation of a design methodology. It is evaluating whether joint cognitive systems and some of the underlying principles are an appropriate design methodology applicable in ATM. And that led to some HMIs designed in such a fashion. But the contribution of C-Share is not to take these HMIs into control centers and say this is how you're working now. The contribution of C-Share is actually to provide evidence whether the underlying design framework is applicable for designing interfaces. So I wouldn't take these interfaces now and say this is what C-Share has provided. It's not. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, it's an instantiation for this particular problem.
Another point that was raised during the final workshop that Max was referring to was, for example, a cost function that could be applied that could help you choose the most appropriate of the solutions that either you yourself are generating or that the automation is providing to you. You see, speeding up aircraft, as you suggested, Peter, comes with a fuel cost penalty, and so ranking or prioritizing various resolutions with a cost function that would be useful.
What do you mean by cost? Is it euros? Is it something that equates to euros? Is it environmental cost?
We need to refer to the POEM project and the more elaborate study of user costs. So that's not a simple answer to that, but suffice it that to say that there are various avenues along which such a tool could be improved or made more sophisticated.
My understanding was that with CISO we're going into business trajectory, user preference trajectory, and that cost would be for the airline to decide on for the tool. So I'm a little bit lost because for an airline, it may be that the cost would be lower if you speed up because you're going to catch. To make sure that you will be on time for the next flight. It's more complicated than just looking at the trajectory itself, the speed, etc. It's the whole concept. So I couldn't understand how you two was lacking from this cost function visible to the operator, and I wasn't sure what the operator meant.
Well, there was always the assumption made that you had to hit the metering fix at a certain point in time, so the aircraft would be sped up in order to be at the exact planned time at the metering fix. That was a simplification, of course, but that makes the cost function a little more contained to the sector then.
But you will have scenarios where whether avoidance would make the fact that you cannot meet your target.
Yeah.
That will happen.
Yeah.
You cannot just dream that you will always be able to fly your aircraft with this trajectory that meets the metering point.
Of course.
Given a number of uncertainties.
And maybe it wouldn't make sense at
all. Again, I mean, this cost function, I couldn't understand what it was about on the controller side. So could you explain a little bit more?
Well, it was a comment made by somebody in the workshop. I cannot really see what that somebody in the workshop had in his or her mind. It was not something that we investigated. It was just a comment given.
Okay.
Yeah.
To come back on the cost, I mean, you can have the cost of the fuel, you can have the cost of the time. It depends on the aircraft, each aircraft.
Yeah.
But there is one function that you will never get, is the cost of the value of the aircraft for the airline.
Hmm.
For instance, you can have an aircraft that is very important to arrive in time, so whatever the cost,
exactly.
The time, but as long as you maintain the schedule, that one will be one more important. And the cost function that you get it from the airline. So you can always have like a kind of composite cost made of several elements to display something that is better than nothing.
Yeah, I agree.
There will be things that will
no, never I agree. Yeah.
I have one question also. When you perform the SWOT analysis, this is a very good approach. It permitted you actually to identify some issues and problems and new research questions. Based on your experience with C-Share, what would the future long-term research topics or research questions which you think we should address in the period of after 2035 or beyond 2050?
Just the top five.
Yeah. The main things we learned, that's also what's said over here, is that looking at more flow kind of control opportunities. In the end, the C-share system that we developed was still requiring the operator to do a lot of, let's say, manual work, aircraft by aircraft work. And I think one of the opportunities that we have also with César coming would indeed be to take that to a higher level, so that that you can somehow say that streams of aircraft will need to be moving through the airspace in a particular way to resolve with particular perturbations. I think that would be the main cardinal question, how to do that, how to support and develop the automation for that.
And maybe on a more philosophical level, the question we touched upon about automation transparency influencing acceptance, workload, situation awareness, task performance.
So basically, in the long term area, these are the main areas you identified, right?
Yeah.
For research.
So obviously, there are many smaller things that can be done, but I think this is the main one. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. I just, it's not a big deal, but I just wanted to know, you said you used four air traffic controllers participated in the exercises, and as I understood, these controllers are retired.
And no.
Do these controllers?
In the experiment they were active controllers or trainees. So they were from the Dutch LVNL, the ANSP in the Netherlands.
And they were either coming from work, so they were actively working, or they were coming from their training center. So we had two trainees and we had two active controllers.
But it was written as former controllers, that's why I asked.
I believe we had former controllers in the first conceptual evaluation, but for the final experiment we had active controllers.
So I have a recommendation. Try and get like master controllers or NATS controllers because they have some of the most advanced interfaces.
Okay.
Particularly for like a 3-year study, you need to be start at the leading edge. Because by the time you've finished, technology may have overtaken you, which I think is some of the comments you're getting from that.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to Max.